Okay, we're going to do a little sound thing here because we're going hybrid. And I see folks online. I'm hoping for a signal that the folks online can hear us in the summit room. Yeah, they can see us. Thumbs up. Thank you so much.
We can hear you.
So, great. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. I know we have community members and students and faculty and staff and instructors. And we wanted to, as we kind of get to a point with our Annex renovation, which started formally the process in 2016, 2017, and several times before that, provide some updates. Right, Joan's laughing. You've been along for this, right, Joan? So I will call on some of you historians here as we go along with this process, but to provide an update of where we are, because while we did finally get state funding was based on 2017 numbers. And if all of you remember your 2017 numbers that you were operating within, that doesn't go as far anymore. So we started the Annex renovation master plan and remodel back in the day because, first and foremost, our students deserve innovative learning spaces. And we are the top educator, especially when it comes to healthcare in this community, in this region, and accessibility. If you have been in the Annex lately, there are stairs only, and you need to come over to main building across a bridge in order to have accessibility between the two floors in the Annex. It was built a while back. So what happens in the state of Colorado is also you can't really do a lot of renovations unless you're willing to update all the safety and accommodations pieces also. So that's what the main part of the renovation was based on, is safety and accommodations to update a really outdated building to enhance the learning environment for our students and the programs that were in that building. So in 2017, we had a master planning process here at ACC. How many of you were involved in that 2017 master planning process? One, two, three, four. Okay, about five. So there's a lot of you who are not. So, and that happens when you have a two-year college because the students cycle through every 2 years. So you have to really count on the students and the faculty and the staff and the people involved to be visionary and thinking ahead of what that's going to be. And then you have to count on the Colorado State Legislature to also be visionary. So we went through a large process then of a master process for the entire campus. What would we imagine? What do we see? We also went through a process of the Annex itself. With all the programs that were in the Annex, what was needed. If they could dream big, what would they have? That included, you know, fitness center pieces. There were some things we were able to do in little parts and pieces. You know, we got that big ass fan and some other things in the fitness center and some doors and some changes of the pieces there. We did a number of things that were just basically what we could fix without being in jeopardy of saying that we wouldn't get any funding, because again, once you fix something, then you have no options for future funding, as Brandon and Julia are in the back nodding, in the state of Colorado, the way that the red tape works. So that brings us to, we did receive funding for the plan that was finally approved in 2017, and then we had to start trying to figure out how do we make those numbers fit with what we want to do and what we learned in COVID, which was a huge thing, right? Like a lot of how we were doing learning changed at that point, and a lot of how healthcare was doing learning changed at that point, and went to a lot more simulation-based was allowable, which before it was not. Clinicals were the way that things were going. So a lot of different things became options for us as we started looking at this renovation. So we wanted to come up today. Again, I'm Lisa Mady Edwards, and I'm the Vice President for Student Affairs. And so I've been involved with this as a member of leadership through the master planning process. I came in 2016 here to ACC, and so started right in on a master planning process, a higher learning commission visit, a number of different things that colleges have to go through to be accredited to be able to offer the degrees and the programs that they do. I think some of the other things that we did were, you'll grow a lot of different things for student access. And that's been important for us in making sure that students have access to the programs that they need to be successful as they go out and join Colorado's workforce in a variety of ways. So, will you introduce yourself, Cheryl?
So let me just open this up because we just jump right on in. And so let me just thank you all for coming and being here today. My name is Stephanie Fuji. I have the honor and pleasure of serving as the president for ACC. I've been here for just a little bit over a year. I joined the college in July of 2021. One of the things that that I would really stress to you, culture is an interesting thing. So I come from the state of Arizona, and I'd been in my previous institution and system for roughly about 25 years. And after 25 years, I kind of knew and had a sense of the culture. And so I would be remiss if I did not share with you that I am learning a lot about the ACC culture. And there's some things that I'm kind of figuring out, and there's things I'm really still struggling with. So one of the things that when I first got here, which was really nice, is people were ever so gracious in terms of allowing me to ask questions and helping to explain things to me. My background is counseling. I truly value getting to know folks and getting to try and understand their perspectives. I hate having to assume. You will often hear me talk about is that I do not wish to assume ill will, because we have enough of that occurring out in the world around us. And so what I would ask is that if you have questions or you're not sure, ask. I cannot stress that enough. And so that's really what I'm looking forward to, this being an opportunity for us, for people to ask if you have questions. I recognize we may not cover everything today. I recognize there may be questions you have that I do not know the answer to, nor does Cheryl or Lisa or some of our other folks in the room may not know answers to, but we will do our very best to try and find out that answer. I will also share with you, I will give you the truth. And I'm going to try and be as direct as possible because that's just the easiest way it is for me to roll. So I'm not going to try and... I try to give things a positive spin, but I'm not going to lie to you because lying involves being tricky, and that just requires far too much energy for me. So we're going to do our very best to give you authentic representation, authentic information as best as we know it. And if we have to research further, we will certainly do our due diligence to be able to do that. And so I just kind of wanted to be able to share that context with you. Also, what I always find interesting is I bring cookies to a lot of events. And so you will see at the back table, I have cookies. And so when I go to individual people's offices, then people will take a cookie. But when I go to group things, it's like, oh, I don't know if you're going to take my cookies or you're afraid of my cookies, or maybe you don't like cookies, which is fine. But I do have gluten-free as an option. And so, and I recognize some folks may be for the fitness center, and so cookies may be not, you know, what you're trying to work against. But please feel free to be able to take some cookies, or you can take some after you leave, because I will share with you. If you don't, then I run the risk of me eating the cookies, and that is never a very good thing, because then I want to fall asleep in the afternoon, and that does not make me very productive. So I just wanted to provide a little bit of that context for you and provide for you a little introduction to me. With that, I'm going to turn this over to Cheryl, who is our new, she's been here less time than me, our provost and vice president for instruction, because she can also share with you kind of the status of where, whereas Lisa shared with you kind of like the history, she can also share with you a little bit of the status. And then, like I said, for sure, we will get to your questions. We have this, that's what this time has been designated for.
All right, so I'm going to stand up and walk out here because I see myself up there and I look like a little tiny ant on the screen. But I'd like to just kind of connect and be a little closer. One of the things I wanted to share just from my perspective, and like you said, I'm the new provost and vice president of instruction here at ACC. For those of you who haven't had a chance to meet me, I come out of Florida, Florida Community College System, working for previously working at Santa Fe College in Gainesville, Florida. I got here February 1st, so I got to experience a little bit of your winter, and I'm getting excited about getting to experience more of your winter. But one of the things I think my perspective that I've gotten to experience since I've been here may be a little different, even than Stephanie's, because I came on when this project was launching, and the part I've been able to have a chance to be a part of is just working with the faculty and staff in these programs and seeing the incredible vision that they have for an interdisciplinary health sciences simulation center at our institution that, in my mind, in the work that I've been able to do and the folks that I've been able to communicate with, is not only incredibly innovative, but maybe some of the first of its kind that is really looking at a end-to-end simulation center. And so I'll give you an idea of some of the things that we've talked about being able to do in this center so you kind of get a vision for where we're going. Using simulation, we can set up, for example, think of an emergency situation. Think of a car crash in the middle of a busy intersection, right? And so right now we take our EMS professionals in and maybe we set something up out here in the lawn, and they go through and they walk through a simulation of what it would be like for them to do that rescue in an intersection. But it's out on the lawn. It's nice and quiet out here, right? Part of the simulation center we'll be able to do is put them in a simulation with 360-degree video and audio where it will sound and feel just like they're in the middle of that busy intersection. And I don't know about you guys, but if I happen to be in that car crash in the middle of that intersection, I want to know that the folks that are coming there have been conditioned and prepared to how to do that rescue in the middle of that chaotic space. The other thing that we've designed is the idea that it's not just going to be EMS personnel on the scene. It's going to be law enforcement personnel. There's going to be other people there after they take that patient and they prepare them for transfer to the hospital. They're going to then put them in an ambulance. They're going to transfer them to a hospital. They're going to hand them off to nurses. And one of the things that I've learned as I've been doing this, nurses and EMS personnel speak entirely different languages. And so how do they have that communication when they come into the hospital to make sure they've passed off to the nurses the care that that patient's going to need in that space? So what we've envisioned in this annex renovation is that end-to-end simulation. So we'll have law enforcement, we'll have EMS, we'll have nursing, even to the point that we have mortuary science included. We have criminal justice. So let's say this was a drunk driver incident. And so now those EMS personnel and those law enforcement personnel need to show up and present and be witnesses in a courtroom in a case. We've got that all included in that process. And one of the challenges we ran into is how do we do that? So what we envisioned in this plan is a main street with a right now, we've got a 12-bay hospital. We have a two-story townhouse because, I don't know, you look around Colorado. I come from Florida. Houses are all flat. My house I live in now has four stories, three sets of stairs. That's a very different simulation that those EMS professionals have to do to know how to go come to a patient request in a bedroom and then transport them down a very small set of stairs in a townhouse. So we have a townhouse where they'll be able to simulate that. We'll eventually have an ambulance bay. We'll have a main street. We already have the courthouse in there. And we were really looking in how do we do this within the facilities we have. The first initial plan that we finished up, I'm looking at Julia, May or so, included an addition off the south side of the building that would help us build out that entire vision with the hospital, with the ambulance bay, with the two-story townhouse, with the simulation rooms. Unfortunately, that vision was going to cost us about $24 million to build. So what we did is backtracked and said, what portion of that can we build within the existing footprint of the building, and how can we fundraise to finish that? So it was a bit of a puzzle to figure out how do we get this all in our building so we can go from where we are today through the first $11.5 million of that vision that we can build out, and then the final vision that will include the expansion out, and I guess that's where south, whichever way south is. I'm still learning, right, that way. The mountains are there, though. West, okay, they're wrapping around. but what? Soggy waffles, okay. So So this is where we are right now. We have that first stage. We've got our design documents now ready to go. I will say our health sciences faculty have been amazing. We've done focus groups. They've come in. We've brought advisory committees in. Our advisory committees have advised us. They've gone to conferences to learn about simulation. We've been doing all kinds of data gathering to envision this multidisciplinary simulation center that we'll create, and an amazing vision, amazing opportunity for our students. We're going to be able to double and triple the number of students that come through our programs when we fully realize this vision. Right now, state of Colorado has huge shortages in EMS, huge shortages in nursing, huge shortages across the gamut in health sciences. We got other programs coming online as well, such as health information management programs to have to do the management stuff, medical lab technologies. All of these programs will be coming on as part of this expansion that we're working through. So I just wanted to give you a high-level vision of what we're creating and what our students will be able to experience. And I'll give it back to you.
So, oh, there we go. She started us right away. I'm going to give you the mic because we have folks online.
I think it will be too loud. Oh, yeah. You said when you were launching it, you involved everyone. I didn't hear you say anything about the fitness center, and that concerns me.
People are going to introduce themselves before their question. So, yeah.
Been here 33 years, student in my master's program and at the fitness center.
So the fitness center was part of the user groups that were talked to. Perry, do you want to talk about the meetings with the architects? You met with the architects as a fitness center director?
Yes, I met with the architects. I felt like, and I'll just be direct as well, I felt like our opinion wasn't considered in the same regard as instruction, and I can understand that in a way. But I would like to have been involved in the entire process as we were in the 2017. And I know we can't go back to how we were in 2017. Things don't do that. But I feel like back in 2017, everyone in the planning process listened to everyone else's concerns. I don't feel like that was done in this case. I'm not sure that there's anything that can be changed on that. Those of you that are here, I'm glad you're here to hear what things are going to be done. And, you know, my thought process is let's just move forward the best we can, because I don't think we can change what's in the past, including the last few months. But I don't believe the planning included us as much as I would like to have seen.
And I'd say that, yeah, that 2017 is when the broad plan was with the community input. The planning that's happening now is with architects, and it's not a campus-wide piece. We're not at that point. This is the next stage where you go down and you focus, because if you have 28,000 people trying to build a house, you'll never get a house. So this stage is one where the instructional pieces and the different pieces were brought in, the fitness center pieces. And we looked, I'll be very direct and honest, we looked at a plan that included no fitness center, taking over the entire footprint. Because I know, but like athletics that we used to have at the college, the legislature does not pay the college to run a fitness center. It's a lovely community piece. But I'm going to be honest, when it comes down to we have to go to the state legislature to get funding, they're going to produce nurses and not a fitness center, right? I mean, that's the cold, hard reality of higher education funding in the state of Colorado. What I'm really proud of is that in looking with the architects and looking at the plans, we are maintaining a fitness center in this plan. But at one point, there was no fitness center in this plan. And so I do believe that the input was taken. I know Perry's not been a process of all that part. I'm telling you that Cheryl and I and Julia and architects of the plans that we've been looking at in May as they've tried to fit everything into this footprint. So that's something that, you know, whenever you talk about plans, especially in an organization in a college, and it gets out of like that, that's where the myths and the different pieces come. So we're not going to talk about every step of those plans along the way, just like you know, we don't go into classes and talk about all these different things along the way. We each have roles of those pieces. So questions?
And I'll jump in because I am new and I wasn't here in the first part. And I will say that there were long conversations about the impact on the fitness center. Unfortunately, we had a limited amount of real estate in this business, in this building. And we had to figure out how do we fit in our student needs in those health sciences programs and those other programs. So we tried to have the least amount of impact on other programs as we could, but knowing that we had to find space to expand these programs. And so part of that was trying to come up with a compromise that would maintain the integrity of most of the fitness center, but would still give us the ability to grow and expand out to the south portion of the campus and be able to build out this larger health sciences vision that we have for building a larger interdisciplinary center. There will be some short-term impact, as there's going to be in all of our programs. We're working on a phase-in. We're going to be moving classes around. We're going to be moving faculty offices around. We're going to be moving a lot of different pieces around to make space for the different stages of the renovation. In a short period of time, as we finish this first phase, law enforcement will still need to be able to use a portion of the fitness center to do their physical conditioning, which is part of what the fitness center provides. In the longer term, there's another space that's going to be built out for law enforcement that will give them space to take that back out of the fitness center and open up some of that space for other uses within the fitness center. But we're all going to have to be crunched a little bit. There's going to be a period of time this summer where a majority of our faculty and staff in the annex will be displaced from their offices for the summer, as will some things happening in the fitness center. And then we'll get back in there as soon as we can. We're trying to minimize displacement no more than one semester at a time for any section of the building. It's tricky. We have limited amount of time to do this. Some of the funding expires on us in 2024, and if we don't get it done by then, we give the money back. And that's the harsh reality of it. And so it's been a challenging puzzle to work through.
I appreciate the honesty and the directness. It's super challenging, I think, making those decisions, and I respect the challenges that you all are working under. Oh, yeah, I'm Scott Gunther. I teach in the English department, or what was formerly known as the English department. We are now the Department of Composition, Creative Writing, and Journalism. I think I have a bunch of questions. The first question I have is, what exactly will change with the fitness center on a permanent basis? So how will the fitness center 5 years from now look differently than it does today? That's the first thing I need to know, just for clarity's sake. We can answer that question. I can go my other ones after that.
So one, there will be complete renovation of the locker rooms. So there will be a new locker room complex that will include both men's locker rooms, women's locker rooms, and some multiple gender single stall spaces with both showers and changing rooms and bathroom stalls. This will allow us to meet ADA requirements. So there'll be ADA accessible showers in all of the spaces that will be right there. Right now, there are not. The ramping and all the ADA accessibility throughout the building will be upgraded. There'll be a elevator added to provide ADA accessibility. That was another piece. That elevator, we had to find a place to do that. That's happening on the south end of the building. That's part of what kind of dictated the space that we can grow and expand to, so how we can do that piece. So there were some architectural elements that were challenging to do. We got a big, heavy, thick concrete building we got to figure out how to deal with, right? The footprint of the fitness center will become a little bit smaller. So the space that's the gymnasium right now is going to become a hospital and a two-story townhouse. We had to have a space that had the height in the building to be able to build the two-story townhouse. It's also going to provide some overlook areas for observation for students so that they can actually observe what's happening in some of those spaces. The fitness center itself will have a little bit smaller footprint. It will still have an open classroom area, and it will have all of the machines will kind of come together a little bit tighter. And so it will shrink the footprint a little bit, but we'll still be able to have a majority of the things we do in there. We will lose the closed classroom space, and that's on our minds to know how do we repurpose that. One conversation is the potential of resurfacing the tennis courts to put some pickleball courts out there. And to reallocate some of those spaces as we grow, There's still going to be more work done in this building as we envision this building, and we're still looking for those larger spaces to be able to accommodate some of those larger gathering spaces for students and things. In the annex, we built some larger spaces already. We're going to build several classrooms that accommodate about approximately 48 students with dividers that can be opened up to create classrooms that in spaces that would accommodate 100 or more people in there for larger group gatherings. So again, looking at how do we repurpose some of the building to both serve our classrooms and accommodate some of the functions that might have occurred in some of those space, that one space in the fitness center that we're going to need to use for the expansion.
So also, so again, in the goal of just trying to be very direct. So first phase, we are losing the gym. We are losing the gym because that is part of the construction. It's going to close for this, but the big gymnasium, okay. You know where the basketball courts are. Where's the dodge? Well, I think of it with the dodgeball, because that's where I know. Oh, see, depending upon how you use the space. Dodgeball, pickleball. So yeah, that is going to be impacted. So just want to be very clear, because I know that folks had some concerns.
It's not coming back.
So long term, we're going to have to kind of work to see figuring out that. But yes, for right now, we're planning on taking over that space. So let me share. No, that's fine. So. I'm a verbal processor, so it's helpful. So let me offer this up. So the institution is trying to think about creatively as we look at all our spaces. Okay. So we have the health annex that we're looking at and we're trying to take care of, but also look at the Littleton campus. Okay. So we are also trying to be mindful, because if you look at this building was built in 1974, okay? The fact that we have how many elevators in this building? 3? 5? And they're really hard to find. I only use one that I use. So part of what, and our theater right now is not ADA accessible, okay, which is just appalling. So part of what one of the things that we are eventually thinking of, but to Scott's point, this is not happening next week. I don't even know if this is going to happen this semester. I have to figure out, and we're working through the timeline. But how do we make the Littleton campus more student, user-friendly, student-accessible kind of space? So when I say long-term, what are we to be thinking about? What I would offer up is that's still on my mind, because we also are talking about master planning for the Littleton campus overall. And that will, once we decide and figure out what our timeline is for that, because that also will involve a legislative ask, once we figure out what the timeline is, that's also when we go back and try and do what we did when we were trying to create the 2017 plan. That's when we'll have to go back and we'll be asking for the broad group input. What does student space? I had shared with student government that we'll be asking them to help facilitate these conversations long term, because I will share with you my observation is the way we used space in 1974 is not the same way we use space in 2021. So that's when I say figuring out long term or figuring out later what that is, that's what I mean by that. Does that help, Scott? Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Okay, Patty has a question.
Hi, I'm Patty Adams, and I'm actually sitting in the classroom with several of my Silver Sneakers students. And I actually have a two-part question. It's my understanding, Dr. Fuji, that probably about 20% of the classrooms in both the annex and the main classroom building are not currently being utilized. Why aren't we restructuring those and leaving our fitness center alone?
I would say that's not actually true, because we haven't been able to rehouse all of the programs in the rest of the building. That may have been true during COVID, but as we've come back from COVID, We are using those classes. Part of the process too was to really expand the size of the classes. So there's about five classrooms in this iteration that really expands our maximum size of the classroom. So we've got some that are going up to 36, some that are going up to 48 and 50. And so that will allow us to expand the cohort sizes of our nursing programs and some of our other programs to really expand the number of students we can get. We are right now only accepting about 25 to 30% or about a third of our applications to the nursing program. And so we want to double and triple those programs. The same thing with EMS and nursing assistant. You may have seen the Care Forward Act that's coming out, making those programs free of cost for students to attend those programs. So we're looking at double and tripling the size of the programs. The other challenge was, is we have portions of the main building that have been renovated recently for biology and other places. We did not have anywhere else in the building that contiguous space we needed to run the type of EMS simulations that we need to run and the type of emergency response simulations that we need to run. Part of this long-term plan will be bringing law enforcement in. I don't know if you guys have been in the North Building. When I first came over there, I went over there and they showed me how that the cracks in the building were so wide that when they put papers on the table, the wind blew through the cracks and blew the papers off the table. Now, I do understand that those cracks have been caulked now, but... You know, yes. So yes, Brandon and his team back, and Devin and his team back there. But finding a place that is built to meet their needs, and those programs are growing exponentially. We just did an analysis of our programs where we need new faculty, and the top like eight are EMS, law enforcement, nursing assistant, all of these medical and health sciences programs that are growing exponentially. And so we will be using those spaces. And remember, these are hands-on programs. These students spend a great deal of time in these classrooms. They are not online programs. They aren't virtual programs. They have to have the physical space.
Right. My second part of that question, though, it's my understanding that EMS is being moved to the legacy site.
EMS will have cohorts both at Legacy, Littleton, and Sturm. Wait a minute, Patty, did you have another question there? Did that answer it?
Yeah, you said that they're going to be in all three locations?
Yes.
EMS is going to be in all three locations. So the location that EMS is currently using in the Littleton campus is going to continue to be EMS?
Yes. And expanded space. That's why we're building the two-story townhouse.
Okay.
Back to you, Scott, since you got one more.
So we're losing the gym?
I don't know what the dance studio is. If it's one and the same.
It's our classroom. From what we understand, you're taking our classroom and our entire gymnasium. So pickleball and silver sneakers classes will be gone. And basketball.
There won't be in those spaces. There will be an open classroom space in the gym that will be available for certain things. No, I'm sorry, in the fitness center. There will be open classroom space in the fitness center that will be established. But yes, that gym portion will go. It will become the hospital and the two-story townhouse.
I just want, so I'm not quite clear because I know LEA uses the fitness center a great deal that they have, and they use the gym. So many of their activities, we're not supposed to be a part of because of some of the activities they do. So if I understand it correctly, this is why I'm really confused, because the LEA program is one of our most profitable programs on campus, right? They bring in a lot of money. Nursing is extremely expensive. EMS and extremely, these are expensive programs for our campus, right? If you look at our per pupil costs, we're spending a lot of money. All of our other programs, right? I mean, all of our guaranteed transfer programs are very inexpensive. And we're losing a proportion of our fitness center You're saying LEA is not important. If we lost that whole thing, they couldn't have an LEA program. Oh, okay. But you said you looked at that. So, but then, okay. So if they're in the open space, we can't have other classes and we can't really be there while they're doing that in their open space, if I understand some of the things that they do during that program.
So they've been at the table the whole time, helping us plan this out. And if you're familiar with the Law Enforcement Academy, they meet over the weekends. And so, yes, we have a space planned into the fitness center that will accommodate all of LEA's fitness center needs. And we have already worked with them to accommodate that space. And most of that work will be done on weekends when no one else is actually using the fitness center. Yeah. Not when it's not open. Right. So we've worked with David and that team, and they are fully in support of the plans that we have in place.
My name is Ryan. The question I had is, with what's being lost with the basketball hoops in that area of the fitness center, is there going to be any effort made to gain something back without throughout the school? Like, I know I'm an avid user of the pool table upstairs, but there's only one and it's extremely old. Are we going to be adding more areas to the school that students can have more involvement and more physical activity?
So yes, that's actually the part that we're looking at and that Dan Belsky and Student Life are talking about and will continue to talk with student government. And they're looking at doing a survey for students in regards to that. What do you want to see? There's been ideas put out there of more pool tables, outdoor ping pong tables, basketball courts outdoors, circuit work out here in the areas that we do have, resurfacing the tennis courts to put pickleball lines in there so that we can have outdoor pickleball. We know it's not all season, though, but we also know that Colorado benefits a lot from great weather. So what are the options that we can do? You know, some various things in regards to an outdoor classroom on those pieces, too, so that, again, you see a lot of different things happening, whether it be yoga or stretch classes, et cetera, those type of things being available. So I'm going to go here and then I'll come back over here.
Thank you. I'm Angela Merlano. I'm the co-editor of the student newspaper named The Pinnacle. And I just had a question regarding the petition that was going around about saving our gym. There was a poster going around saying sign our petition to save our gym. Where does our tuition money go? What is your response to that?
I've seen the petition, which had a lot of really interesting things, including the fact that we serve Elbert County. So I thought that was interesting. There's a lot of pieces in that I think are based on, I'm not sure what, but tuition doesn't go to the gym, first and foremost. It goes to pay for faculty and staff and pieces there. There is a student health and wellness fee, and what that covers is access to the fitness center, mental health counseling, wellness programming, and a number of different things around that. So community members join the gym, and Silver Sneakers is a very important part of our fitness center, but it's an auxiliary service, which means it is not run through state operating dollars. However, the building is a state property. So we have to get permission to do it. We have to get legislative funding, all those pieces. It's not a private entity. So I'm trying to think. We have looked at that petition. We've reached out to the organizers to say, here's some answers to the questions. So your tuition dollars go to educate you so that you can enter the workforce. They also help, I mean, again, pay for lights and heat and that kind of stuff, but IT, all the things it takes to run a college. But yeah, and I think if you remember this kind of way back when, one of the challenges for colleges is what is the core mission of the college, right? When push comes to shove and money gets tight, what is the core mission of our college? It is to educate students to be able to transfer on or to enter the workforce. And then there's a bunch of other really cool things that we get to do because we are really innovative and talented as a college. So, for example, we were able to start the Elevate program. We're the only community college in the state of Colorado who has anything like that because we're innovative and we believe in access. We have a super strong Silver Sneakers program. We're a college that chooses to keep community in our name because we believe in that. So those are the type of things. But when push comes to shove, we used to have a softball team and a baseball team. I would love to have a softball team and a baseball team. So, right? We had a lot of athletics, right? The archivist and library. I would love to do that. That is not central to the mission of our college right now. And so spending resources on that would be irresponsible.
My name is Lexi Ross. I'm a student. I guess my question kind of has to go off of Ryan's question. I'm kind of under the impression, like, I guess I just don't really understand if that you're saying that you're trying to find solutions for the students who use the fitness center and other places like a basketball court, pickleball courts, outdoors, things like that. But it doesn't sound like that's part of the renovation that's happening right now. It sounds like that's going to be something pretty far along in the future. Well, if it took this long to, if you said you started in 2017 to just start doing this for the fitness center and in this annex renovation, I feel like, to me, I mean, I'm only 19, so 5 years is a quarter of my life, and that's like a fairly long period of time in my eyes, but so I'm kind of wondering the timeline of that, if you have.
Okay.
So two things, first off, and then to also, what's your name again, dear? Lexi, to answer Lexi's question. So first off, as Lisa has shared with you, as Cheryl has shared with you, I've been working in higher education for 30 years. I have never been a place where the legislature or foundations have said, we're going to give higher ed more money. In fact, community colleges usually get significantly less funding than the university. We are dependent upon tuition, which is enrollment, and nationally, community college enrollment is down 20%. The fact that ACC has been able to maintain enrollment is huge. My previous system, which is in a growing metropolitan area, is down 10%. So the fact that we've been able to do that is significant, and that speaks to the work of our faculty and staff, which your tuition dollars help us to be able to have. And I will also add that the faculty and staff in Colorado, particularly in the Denver metro area, are paid significantly less than the mean nationally for a large metropolitan area and for the mean of Denver. However, they stay because they are committed to the mission of the institution. So I share that because we are having to face harder and harder decisions. And so the priority becomes, what is the responsibility of the community college and higher education's landscape? And so therefore it is education, it is training. And so that is central to our mission. Part of that mission is also wanting to see our students be successful, wanting to facilitate a sense of belonging and community. And that is why we look at our spaces. That's why the institution is making investment in terms of renovation of classroom spaces. Also renovations we're looking at, and Lisa helped lead this as well as Dan Balski, how can we make our student spaces better upstairs? I remember when I first came here, nobody was using the pool table because we were kind of in this hybrid mold. I never see when this pool table is not being used because I walk by it all the time. And sometimes I work late and the pool table is still being used. So we know that that is important. So we want to be able to do that as much as we can. But when we have to prioritize between what is central to the mission, healthcare is critical to this state. We learned that in the pandemic. We knew that beforehand, before I even got here. But the governor has invested significant funding in short-term certificates to meet the healthcare needs of our community. And so that's why when you say, are you taking away my gym for healthcare spaces? Yeah, we are. We're taking the gym for classroom space. Let me get, there is a bright side. There is a bright spot, bless his heart. I'm sorry, Nick. So, okay, this is what I love about this guy. I want a basketball court inside. I love dodgeball. When we play dodgeball, it's a lot of fun. But where I am right now, and this goes to Lexi's point, where I am right now, here today, I have a finite amount of money. I have a finite amount of money. And so I may want the gym, the basketball court. I want all of that stuff. But finite amount of money says you can only pay for this much. And so for right now, I'm not able to deliver on this. When you ask, when is it going to happen? And I apologize, I'm old. So 5 years, it goes like that. What my hope is in 10 years, I'm able to actualize what many of us are, you know, dreaming about for what this campus space really, truly looks like. I will share with you right now, 85% of our students attend part-time. They're not even here. So part-time means less than 12 credits. That means they're not even here 24 hours a week. So do I invest a lot of money in space where I never see students? As opposed to, that's why I look at things like the pool table. I see students there all the time. So that's where if I'm going to invest money, you know, there's a group of students that play video games regularly. I see them all the time. So I start thinking, what could that possible space look like? You're right. If I can get there in 10 years, pretty good. That's why I will tell you, college is funded based upon tuition, what the money the state legislature gets us, and then grants. We are a college that is very, very aggressive on grants. And so really what my plan is, as I talk with folks here, and this is why I'm not being definitive, because we're all kind of trying to brainstorm different ideas, and then we have to timeline and prioritize and then timeline, is to be thinking about how do I raise money for the ideal? Because when they went out in 2017, they thought $11 million would be great. In order to build what we want, we're talking closer to 25, 30. And so therefore, when I think about when we try to pull together this plan, submit it within the next couple of years, it usually takes a couple of years in order for the legislature. It took them 4 years before they would approve it. And so that's when we start thinking about what might that be? What might that look like? But as you said, it's not going to happen. You know, will it happen during your tenure here? I hope you're out in 5 years. I want you out in 10 years. We want you to get you out and doing good stuff. But it will happen. But 10 years is kind of roughly what I'm playing around with.
And I'm talking short term next semester. So as far as some of the things, right, what can we add of activities? What can we add of things that are not requiring a foundation, a wall, those type of things? Put some basketball hoops outside so that we have on this big patio out here. You know, can we put some basketball hoops there so when the weather's nice, people can play? Can we add some pool tables, shuffleboards, some other things that people, you know, generally think? Are there activities, right, that students are like, we want to see this activity? You know, Zumba used to be big. This used to be big. What's the latest thing? Do students want access to that? Is that something we can offer here? Is that something we can offer somehow to our students? You know, Perry and Kendra were really great during COVID. They got the online streaming stuff going, so students have access to that app. So there's some stuff that we can do in the short term, but as far as like building a facility, and I'll just say the other thing, Red Rocks has a beautiful, beautiful fitness center. Their students are charged $120 a semester, all of them, whether they use it or not, whether you ever go in there, you have to pay for that. That's a lot of money for a student every semester, $240. They chose to do that. They did choose to do that. So that's something too we can talk about with students. If students choose for different things, they can up their fees, but that has to be done by a student vote.
We love dance club, yes, and we love to dance. Okay, where can we dance if that's gone?
That's one of the things we're going to have to figure out. Dan and I have been talking about this. Where can we dance if the studio is not there? Is there a place that we can repurpose? Is there something we can schedule? Is it something of using the stage, you know, and the stage there and doing dance class there? Are there other places that we can do the things that we need to do that we know are near and dear to us at ACC, right? So this is our like problem solving piece that now, again, so the issue from 2017 is they thought they'd be able to do everything and not have to take the gym away. Fast forward to now, as everybody looks at it, when we get the money, this is the only way that we're going to be able to make this work to deliver what we need to deliver. So given that, now we have to do some other problem solving. So those are the pieces. But really, again, we had several plans that we were trying to decide between that are the realization of that 2017 decure.
Hi, I'm Courtney. I'm in the library. I'm just curious what the long-term vision is for other programs in the Annex, like automotive tech. What are they going to do?
Well, we'd like more space for them, too. So as the employers, right?
So I will share with you. I can't share a lot of details, but we've actually got some major conversations going with some potential donors that can help us expand and grow those programs. Looking at things like how do we prepare students to work on electric vehicles? These are things that our advisory committees are telling us. They don't have personnel now that understand the electronics and the computer systems and everything behind electric vehicles. And so how do we prepare our students to do that? So yes, we've got lots of conversations, and all depends on resources and money and how we do that. One of the things I will share with you, part of the process will be putting in a whole lot of fire suppression and new lighting and new ceiling tiles and everything throughout the entire Annex. We're also going to see some of that come into this building as well. The automotive already had fire sprinklers and everything, so we don't need to do that one. So some of the upgrades that we're doing to the physical infrastructure of the building to bring us up to today's standards didn't need to be done out in that space. There are some major work we need to do out there. We need some flooring out there. We need some other things, and those things are in the pipeline as well to get done, and as well as some expansion things. And I'm going to say Scott has been incredibly patient over here. So
I think I'll speak for myself. I am absolutely supportive of everything that we're doing as an institution and supportive students. I am absolutely supportive of everybody here advocating for changes that they're concerned with. I think this speaks to Lisa, and Lisa, I feel like I have a good enough relationship with you where I can ask you a hard question. To me, a lot of this boils down to process and involving stakeholders in some really hard decisions that happen in that process. And what I heard Perry say is that she was involved early on in the process, and the fitness center was involved early on, and they had some feedback in that. When the process had to change because of the budgetary commitment, I don't know if stakeholders were involved in the discussions about those changes and really given an opportunity to help troubleshoot those changes with the college, because they would have ideas that would matter too. And so, like I said, ultimately I'm supportive of every decision that's going on here, but I'm not supportive of the process. And maybe the process isn't that important to the people making the decisions, but if we continue to not involve stakeholders in the process of being involved in the things that they care about, I worry what the long-term consequences are for our community.
And I'd say that, yeah, I meet with my team every other week, and we talk a lot about process. And I'd say that I think it's also very hard when things that you're passionate about feel like a loss. So people can give lots of input into processes, and we gather lots of input on different things. That doesn't mean that at the final time, the decision's gonna come out the way that you wanted it to. I'll be honest, we weren't at that point, because that wasn't a point for any input. That was a point for decisions. I agree. But honestly, that wasn't a part of coming back and saying, we have these three plans. Which plan do you prefer? It wasn't a time for community input in there. Like, we don't want to affect, we all know, we don't want to lose the gym. We don't want to lose the studio. We don't want to lose the third place that it is for Silver Sneakers. Again, we've had people who've been coming for 33 years in that part. We don't want to lose any of that. So we can have the conversation and the process and the grieving part of it. But, again, and I mean, I'll be honest. Yeah. It's hard to hear. It sucks, doesn't it? Yeah. I really enjoyed sitting at the table making the decision too, by the way, Scott. So that was super fun. Yeah. 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 It does. It does.
And so that, I think that's also partly one of the, I recognize that's a challenge I have, because the communication patterns that I thought or lines that existed are not necessarily as clear and consistent as I might have thought or hoped. So it requires me and us to think creatively about when we are soliciting input, we can't go and ask just this person to go and find it, because they may or may not. You know, depending upon things come up. So it's like, okay, how do we do it in about four or five different ways? And so that also has helped inform. What I will also say is that we are constantly, I appreciate, Scott, you sharing regarding process, because we're learning a lot, or at least let me say this. I am learning a lot about ACC's processes in terms of how process is informed by culture and vice versa. And so, and I haven't, and I'll be frank, I have not completely navigated that yet. I looked at cabinet to help give guidance. But we've had a lot of changeover in leadership at the institution, a lot of changeover in staffing. And so we're adapting and trying to do the best that we can, but we are learning, you know, but hopefully we will work hard to do better. And that's something that we are learning as well.
And I've got to go real quick. So I just wanted to kind of wrap, come back around, Scott, to some of your questions there. You know, I'm pretty new, so I'm coming into this. And one of the things I will share with you, all of these constituencies that we're talking about being at the table and hearing from, I have heard from in my process of being here. I think one of the places where it's really challenging is none of us are architects, none of us are builders. And so what I watched is a process where all of this information was gathered, and Julia helped manage all of this through multiple conversations with multiple different constituencies across the college. Every single bit of this was put into a entire laundry list of all the requirements that we had going into this project. And in the end, we had to trust our architects and our construction managers and everyone to tell us, this is the way the puzzle fits together for you guys. We can't hit everything we need, but this is the best way we can get the puzzle together for you guys to get the outcomes that you want in the academic programs that you that are set as a priority in this original 2017 plan, so that we can meet the guidelines under which we were given this money to spend. Otherwise, we were not meeting our requirements. And there have been many times along the way, I'm like, I think we need to do this. I think we need to do that. And they keep saying, no, this is not part of the original plan. It is not what we got the money for. We would be held accountable by the state for not doing what we said we would do when we requested this money. And unfortunately, we'd all like to do a lot of things, but again, we're not architects, we're not builders, and we've had to trust those folks to tell us, this is the way the puzzle worked together. We had to make some hard decisions. There's a lot of things we had to leave on the table with this one. And unfortunately, that's where we're at. And I apologize, I have got to go to another meeting.
So I want to be respectful of time. So I believe it's like a little bit after 12 o'clock. I can stick around. So if folks have questions, Lisa can stick around if folks have questions. So if you have questions, we'll do our very best to try and answer them. Also, you know, one of the things that is helpful, we've been working with Tina to think about how we can do a better job communicating. And so looking at creating, I don't know if we have the web page up yet. We're looking at creating a web page that kind of gives you timeline. You know, kind of like what we did with the Stern project, kind of giving folks the timeline, what's happening, and putting things up when we can. I will tell you, lots of speculation. At one time, we had so many plans that I couldn't tell you what plan we were doing. And so, but as we get greater clarity and as we're moving forward, we're going to work real hard to be able to do that. So I encourage folks to also look at that. And like I said, Lisa and I'll stick around if folks have any additional questions. And then also please feel free to grab some cookies. Okay. Thank you all for being here. Appreciate it.